thank you from me and all of the people that asked you to come here today for being champions for clean water. So glad that you're here. We've got snacks over there, we've got beverages, and we've got a big slate of speakers today that I think you're going to be interested in listening to. I want to thank this sea of blue for being champions for clean water. It's so nice to see all of the blue out there, because this is really about protecting water in the state of New Hampshire. We live in a politically charged environment. My wife is here, my daughter is here. We can't sit at the dinner table without having some type of a polarized debate, right? But there's one thing that we are all aligned around, and that is that we're talking about a bill, 1454, that is not a blue or a red issue, especially when we're talking about safe drinking water, public safety and health, recreational enjoyment, and how contaminated water would influence in areas that we know would be inevitably affected. We have all of you. We have thousands of people across the state that have signed a petition. We have all of the members of our coalition, and we've got all of our legislators, right, who have already done the right thing. You know, this has already come through. It passed in the House with an overwhelming voice vote. So how about a round of applause for that? It passed in the Senate by a majority, bipartisan, wide margin. How about a round of applause for that? All we need them to do is do what they already did. So let's do this. We got a bunch of Republicans coming in right now, and we love them to death, right? This isn't blue or red. This is a common sense issue, right? We're going to do this. On three, I want you to repeat after me, right? I want you to say, thank you for protecting New Hampshire's waters. One, two, three. Thank you for protecting New Hampshire's waters. One more time. Regulation that is on the books with DES that says that it is okay to site a landfill within 200 feet of a body of water. That makes absolutely no sense. Look what's going on in Merrimack, and you're going to hear a lot more about that. We've got Representative Rosemary Rung, we've got Wendy Thomas going to speak about all those things, and it's unimaginable that anybody would think, with contamination that's going on in Allenstown and cancer clusters around the seacoast, that we could possibly even imagine considering thinking that it's okay to site a landfill within a mere 200 feet from a body of water, okay? So how about a round of applause for let's do the right thing today and override this veto. Over to our slate of speakers. But before I leave the microphone, I want to remind you of a couple of things. Don't listen to the lobbyist doublespeak when they say that there is no place in this state to site a landfill. I ask you to take a look to this banner over to my left. That entire green area is all of the available space that has suitable soil to properly and safely site a landfill. It's only the red areas that would be affected by that. And so don't listen to all that. There's plenty of places to put landfills safely. Look, we'd love to say that we don't need landfills anymore. It's just, we're just not there yet. So when we do need them, let's site them safely. And then the other thing is this. A lot of the doublespeak is saying that if this law goes into effect, that this would inhibit existing landfills from expanding. That is simply not true. That passage in yellow there is taken directly from House Bill 1454, word for word. Under no circumstances does this bill, if it becomes law, will it affect any
other existing landfill that's in operation at the time of its passage. So with that, you've heard enough from me. It's time for me to introduce one of our key sponsors, the prime sponsor, a true champion. She has been a champion for the North Country. She's been a champion for the environment. She's been an outstanding leader for House Bill 1454. And let me introduce Representative Edith Tucker. And Edith, let the music play.
Okay. I'm here to speak on this bipartisan bill. I want to emphasize that this bill was researched, promoted, and cobbled together, changed over time. And we have a bill that is truly bipartisan and should be passed in New Hampshire today with an override vote. There was a tremendous group that came together, started small, grew and grew. And I think it's amazing that people were able to come together across town boundaries, across county boundaries, and reach the conclusion together that this was the right way to go. And I firmly support every word of this bill. So, I wanted to pick up on what was said earlier, and that is, I want to repeat this important news. Any claim that this bill will affect in any way whatsoever the potential expansions of existing landfills in New Hampshire, including, but not limited to, the facility in Success in Berlin or the turnkey facility in Rochester is simply not true. This key sentence in the bill, as passed by House and Senate, is unambiguous and absolutely clear. And the quote is, "Nothing in this paragraph shall be construed to prohibit the expansion of any landfills that are in operation at the time this paragraph takes effect." As the prime sponsor, I want you to know that's always been my intention and that of the other 10 sponsors, many of whom are here today in the House and Senate, to craft a bill that will be applied only to new landfills. It's come up as sort of a rumor or rumble in the Senate. This is a problem. It's not a problem. That's why I emphasize it. We believe we succeeded and that it's impossible to read this sentence any other way. Furthermore, I discussed this matter at length with Director Mike Winsat of DES in February and March of this year. And he assured me that using this language avoided this problem. So, I think that we need to realize that it is very hard for people to change a vote. And if there are people in the House or Senate who change their vote and now support an override, I hope that you will support them at the polls. I hope that you'll support them with emails and let them know you understand it's hard to make a decision and then change it. This is what we're asking some people to do today, and it's a difficult thing to do. I'm very hopeful today that we will get the override, and I ask you to support me.
How about a bigger round of applause for Representative Tucker and her champion of this incredibly smart bill for New Hampshire. So let me take a moment to introduce our next speaker. Representative Rosemary Rung is seeking her third term in the New Hampshire House representing the town of Merrimack. She serves on the Municipal and County Government Committee. Rosemary graduated from UNH with a degree in biochemistry and had a 30-year career in analytical chemistry and then public affairs before retiring. She has three grown children and two grandchildren. Her legislative interests are in environmental protection, specifically in the area of PFAS and cyanobacteria. Please welcome Representative Rosemary Rung.
This is my fight song. Take back my fight song.
Thank you. Thank you all very much for all you've done to help get the override vote on HB 1454. As Tom said, I'm Rosemary Rung, and I represent the town of Merrimack, which is ground zero for the largest groundwater contamination in New Hampshire history. It costs us our health, our lives, our peace of mind, and millions of dollars, and we're still counting them. Let me tell you something about groundwater, and all water for that matter. It flows. It's impossible to get it back in this container. And this is true for all liquids, whether it's lake, whether it's river, whether it's groundwater. Liquids, like landfill leachant, flow as well. Leachant that contains PFAS and other toxins. Once this leachant, which will always end up escaping a landfill, enters a lake, a stream, a river, or other groundwater, it can't be taken back. Just like my water's gone, but I'm glad you have some over here. It will flow and flow and flow and flow into our drinking water wells, which has happened in Merrimack and continues today, into our swimming holes, into our favorite fishing spots. It's also in our fish, and it will contaminate all that we treasure in the Granite State, our environment, our families, our pets, our health. The only way to stop it is to make sure landfill leachant doesn't flow into our water. The only way to stop it is to override the veto of HB 1454. Thank you. In a little while, hundreds of elected representatives will file into the State House, they're doing it now, the People's House, to vote whether to override the veto or not. Let those representatives and senators hear us loud and clear. Override 1454. Join me. Override 1454. Override 1454. Override 1454. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you so much, Representative Rung, and we wish you the best of luck in your term and your seeking election here in November. Our next speaker, Wendy Thomas, has been in the fight to protect her town's water, air, and land from industrial pollution since 2016. In 2018, she, along with two other water warriors, Kathy Stack and Nancy Murphy, were elected state rep by the town of Merrimack. She works as the executive director of the New Hampshire Challenge, which advocates for the disabled community in New Hampshire, and she also works in energy efficiency in New Hampshire, counseling businesses on energy-saving techniques and resources. Wendy, who is currently running for state rep in Merrimack, has lived in Merrimack for 32 years. She has six children with her husband, Mark Nozell. Please welcome Wendy Thomas.
Hi, everyone. Everyone in the back, hi. So, I'm Wendy Thomas.
I'm a mother of six kids, six brilliant, lovely, wonderful children, who are actually young adults now. They wouldn't want me to call them children. I've been a resident of Merrimack for over 30 years. As it was stated, I'm the executive director of a nonprofit that advocates for the disabled community, a former state rep, and I am a water warrior. Thank you. And I am here with a cautionary tale. In 2016, I joined the Merrimack Citizens for Clean Water because there was some discussion about something called PFAS chemicals in our water from an industrial company up the street called Saint Gobain. Now I live 3 miles from 3 miles, not 200 feet, 3 miles from Saint Gobain, and I have a private well. The state told me I had nothing to worry about because my house was so far away from Saint Gobain. We got our well tested in 2016. The numbers were so high that we had to immediately stop using our well water. We put in a full house filtration system with a reverse osmosis system, which cost us about $5,000. We could afford it. Many families in my town cannot afford that. And since 2016, my family, remember I've got six kids, at the time they were all living at home, we have survived on bottled water, because if you cannot use a private well that your house is connected to, you do not have water. In 2021, we got our private well retested again, and the results were higher than they were 6 years ago. In 2022, I was diagnosed, just a couple months ago, I was diagnosed with invasive breast cancer. It's not the worst kind, but it's a bad one. I got my blood tested for PFAS chemicals. Remember, the state told me I had nothing to worry about, 3 miles from the contamination. I have 12 PFAS chemicals in my body that are above the toxic level allowed for humans. My PFAS total chemicals in my body are 38 times the maximum value that is allowed for humans. My PFOA total number, I have more than 99% of it in my blood than the average American. And this is after 6 years. This is me being a water warrior. This is me knowing how to protect myself, putting in a whole house filtration system. If it got me, it's going to get you. PFAS chemicals are linked to many cancers, including breast cancer. They are known to be hormone disruptors. My cancer is hormone dependent. We're trying to figure out what that means. What I do know is that the price Merrimack pays to live in a town that is industrial polluted is to sacrifice parts of our bodies to the altars of corporate greed. The bottom line, often with environmental contaminants, you can't see, smell, or taste them. And by the time you figure out it's poisoning you, it's too late. I am a water warrior. I know about PFAS, and yet I couldn't protect myself or my family. So act now. Use common sense. Stop corporations from poisoning our water, soil, and our bodies. Our elected officials must vote to override the veto on 1454 like their lives depend on it, because God knows ours do. Thank you all for being here, and be in good health.
Thank you for that incredible story, Wendy. We wish you the best in your race for being reelected to the House of Representatives. And we also wish you a very speedy recovery with what you're dealing with. Our next speaker, Dr. Adam Finkel, lives in Dalton and is or has been a professor of environmental health and sciences at Princeton, Penn, and the University of Michigan. He was the chief regulatory official at the United States Occupational Safety and Health Administration in the Clinton and the G.W. Bush administrations, and has been a member of the EPA Science Advisory Board. Adam is also co-author of House Bill 1454,
He's been a strong advocate to support, now in overriding 1454, obviously. Please welcome to the stage Dr. Adam Finkel.
I'm going to tell you two short stories that each claim that it can't possibly happen. One of them is completely false, and the other one is completely true. None of the few opponents of this bill has or will impeach a word I'm going to say today, because they can't. All they have is spin and insults and outrageous slap lawsuits and worse. The latest industry lie, let's not sugarcoat it, it's a lie, is that 1454 would jeopardize existing landfills that want to expand. Oh, that's my problem. But the sponsors and I wrote this key sentence, and you can see it. It's plain English. Don't give away my. And only a shameless lobbyist could say that that means the opposite of what it says. So the first story comes straight from the industry, who thinks somehow it's a fine idea to truck 18 million tons of PFAS-laden trash 150 miles or more from the source of generation and bury it in a sand and gravel pit next to a pristine glacial lake and a wild and scenic river. When DES asked one landfill company at a public hearing about the possibility of environmental pollution, they replied, "It can't possibly happen." They want you to believe that importing clay into the site and compacting it, and then adding a thin film of plastic over it, makes the landfill foolproof. But the peer-reviewed literature makes it clear, compacted clay liners often crack before they're even completed, and the plastic liners often break upon installation or shortly thereafter. That's why it's so important to bury trash in good non-porous soil at a sensible distance from lakes, rivers, and drinking water wells. Think about the scale here. One large landfill could create enough leachate to add 4 inches to the entire surface of Lake Winnipesaukee, or enough to fill Forest Lake's basin 2 to 7 times over. And we see the failures of landfills all around us, most recently a vast leak of PFAS into Lake Memphremagog in the Vermont-Canadian border. But every time a landfill pollutes a lake or a river, the companies in the state rush in to say, well, yeah, but that was the fault of the old, unlined portion of the landfill. How convenient. The fact is, while landfill technology has improved over the past 20 years, we have no idea what the average failure time of a new landfill is, because there are no old new landfills. All we have are improved ones that haven't been around very long. Oh, and ones where the operators go away for the weekend and let the leachate ponds overflow. It can happen here, there, or anywhere. And our bill simply says, let's have it happen where the harm done can be found, mapped, and hopefully fixed before it's irreversible. How can you be against that? I don't get it. Here's my other story. A couple of landfill companies have apparently convinced the governor that if we can't put the next landfill wherever we please, we won't be able to put one anywhere. So trash will pile up in the streets, property taxes will go up when New Hampshire has to start shipping its waste out of state. And by the way, we won't build a recycling center in Manchester, one that will make us a tidy profit, because we'd rather spite you than make money. Now it's my turn to say that can't possibly happen. I defy anybody out there to explain how putting at most 14% of our state off limits to landfilling can possibly make it harder to site the next landfill. We need about 300 acres at most for the rest of the century to bury all of our trash. So look at the vast amount of area that's green on this map, and walk by and look at the tiny yellow square in the third little rectangle. That's 1,000 acres. That's more than what we need. I think Representative Matt Simon from Littleton, a Republican, is going to say on the floor today something like this: if we can't find a place in that vast green area to put the tiny yellow dot, then we need a different solution to our trash problem. So to show you just how nutty this claim is, I'm going to repeat it for a problem that we solved decades ago. Imagine that every public pool in the country did not have a sign like this one. Caution, no diving in shallow end. And there was a bill out there to require these signs. Veto it, or no one will ever dive again anywhere. Oh my God, I can hear them shouting. No, you know what will happen. People will get off their duffs and they'll walk 50 feet to the deep end where it's safe to dive. Broken necks will decrease. And no one will notice the cost, because there is no cost in doing exactly what you want just at any of the number of safe locations that are vast. Just want to riff for just a minute on the latest spin that we've been hearing. So Representative Tucker already talked about the existing landfills letter. I just want to say, off the cuff, there's a letter that was sent to the governor by the operators of the Carberry landfill in Berlin Success. And they made the claim, in addition, that it somehow affects them, which it clearly doesn't, that the calculation used in the bill to estimate how long it will take for the leachate to reach the nearest water body is somehow technically flawed. So here's a sentence for you. I'm going to paraphrase. We took one number for the conductivity, we took one number for the slope, we took one number for the porosity that we got out of a book of porosity numbers. This resulted in a calculated seepage velocity of 15 feet per year and an estimated time of travel to the nearest river of 150 years. You know who wrote that? The people from Mount Carberry. They are doing it right. In 2009, they'd used the calculation that we're asking them to do, not them because it doesn't apply to them, but asking new landfills to do from now on. So somebody convinced the one landfill in the state that's located in good clay soil and that did the right time of travel calculation 13 years ago, that there's something wrong with the time of travel calculation. This is insane. So I'll finish. The secret superpower of HB 1454 isn't that it provides great health and environmental benefits. It isn't that it follows the lead of the landfill industry's two trade associations, who wrote to Congress in May after EPA declared PFAS to be ultra-hazardous and admitted that cleaning up landfills leaching PFAS will cost the nation hundreds of billions of dollars. It's that it provides these immense health and environmental benefits at zero cost. The worst case scenario is that somewhere out there, one developer will have to find a different landowner. One who owns one of the six of every seven tracts where landfilling is safe, and one landowner will have to find a buyer who plans to do anything with his land except bury trash on it. It's simple, it's science, it's a win-win for the state and senators and reps. It is your legacy for the voters. Protect their water from careless landfill development by promoting careful landfill development. Follow the science, but especially follow the economics. No diving in the shallow end will save the state hundreds of millions in cleanup costs. Override this veto and let's build a bridge to the 20th century, which is when most companies and many states learned how to bury trash more safely. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Finkel. Never cease to amaze me with everything that you bring to the table. But I'll tell you, you really did amaze me. Not only did you try to hit the notes that Art Garfunkel actually sang, you actually did hit the notes that Art Garfunkel actually sang. So how about a round of applause for Adam's rendition of Bridge Over Troubled Water? Okay. Our next speaker, she began her environmental career on the West Coast as an assistant professor in geological engineering. She did a four-year tour in the New Hampshire government in the mid-80s and has spent the remaining years as an environmental consultant in New England engineering companies, including starting, growing, and selling her own firm, New England Environmental Strategies Incorporated. During the last 10 years, she now practices part-time as a senior consultant at Calix Environmental LLC, an environmental and compliance consulting company in Colebrook, New Hampshire. Her consulting specialty is in forensic hydrology, which she practices in many states around the United States. She holds a bachelor's degree in geology from the University of New Hampshire, a master's in engineering from Washington State. She is a licensed geologist in several states and currently serves on the New Hampshire Professional Geology, I have another word, Licensing Board. please welcome Muriel Robinette.
Thank you all for coming and supporting New Hampshire's clean water. I don't want to take a lot of your time because it's really spent talking with the legislators as they come through, and that's really what we need to be doing, continuing to educate them. But I want to tell you three things, and they'll be short. But why do we need this bill? How does the bill actually help us maintain clean water? And where the heck should we site the next landfill in New Hampshire? So from the standpoint of why do we need the bill, we talk about landfills, but they're actually landfill facilities. You need to think about the fact that it's more than just the footprint of where we bury the waste. We also have piping, we have tanks, we have trucks, we have all sorts of operators that are collecting that landfill juice, which forms by water flowing through the waste, but it's collected, stored, handled, and is trucked off site. So as you drive up I-93 or I-89 or 109 or 125 or any of these roads, you may pass a tanker truck carrying landfill leachate, because that's what happens to it. The landfill leachate is taken to a treatment plant. So when you think about a landfill leaking, think about the facility, because it has to do with, besides the actual liner, it also has to do with the piping, the tanks, the storage areas, the trucks that are there to receive the waste. So categorically, we can say all landfill facilities leak. That's a 100% true statement. So how is it that this bill, HB 1545, helps us? 1454, excuse me, I'm only slightly dyslexic. The bill helps us because it gives us time. So often we talk about the contamination and as it moves along the soil and down into the groundwater, there's a time frame in which it takes to hit the bodies of water that we're concerned about. We need to be able to react within that time frame. It's not something you can snap your finger and pull something back that has spilled or leaked over time. So all House Bill 1454 does is it gives us a 5-year window, and we're using a groundwater travel time calculation, which is, number one, well known, simple, is used today in New Hampshire for other programs of which we are providing DES technical data to evaluate, and it's also used by our neighbors for actually landfills. So we're trying to apply this known science to a landfill siting criteria. That's all it is, and it does a marvelous job in helping to protect our water. So we get back to the heebie-jeebies here. Oh my gosh, everything's gonna get shut down and we're gonna have waste coming up in the streets, and our taxes are gonna go up, the big heebie-jeebie. Well, if you look at the figure over here, and could you bring that closer to me, please, if that's possible? That figure, yes. This is our beautiful state of New Hampshire, which has been studied by people like me for the last 100 years. And about 40 years ago, the Geological Society, in conjunction with the Department of Environmental Services, did mapping, and they were trying to determine where there was valuable resources in the state for drinking water. At about 15,000 years ago, there was about a mile of ice over our head when the glaciers came through, and it laid down deposits of material that carry our water. And so on this map of New Hampshire, the orangey-red areas are those where there's the sand and gravel. It's called stratified glacial drift, which is a fancy name of where there's a lot of it and it can hold water and we can pull it out for drinking, clean water. Assuming it's clean if we don't have contamination in it. And the green part of the state that's mapped here is actually covered with some type of till, which is a silty clay material. And it's what the glaciers left behind. Thank you very much. It makes our Paxton soils. Sometimes it makes it hard to grow our vegetables in. We sometimes have to add a little sand to it in order to lighten it up so our carrots aren't this big, but the carrots are longer. So all we're saying is that with our House Bill 1454, let's site the next landfill in this clayey type soil, the till, which happens to cover approximately 86% of our state. So with a state with this many acres, that's 4.5 million acres that we have available to us to find that next 300 acre site that'll take care of our waste. So again, thank you all for coming here to help support this override, and let's protect our water. Thank you again.
Thank you, Muriel. That was outstanding. I'm going to first ask if Representative Walter Stapleton is out here. Is he out here? I don't think he is because I know he's got a conflict. Okay. Representative Stapleton isn't out here, but there is a tremendous story. Remember when I said earlier that, you know, even though we are champions for clean water and we're all here in a sea of blue, that House Bill 1454 is not about blue, it's not about red, at least as it relates to political affiliation or loyalty. Representative Stapleton is a member of the Republican Party, and he sits or sat on the House Environmental and Agriculture Committee. So during the process, we needed to testify and present all of the benefits as to why House Bill 1454 would be a good bill. The committee was basically majority red, minority blue, and those kinds of situations when you're pushing through environmental bills sometimes are challenging. Well, Walter Stapleton didn't support the bill when it was House Bill 177 because he felt like the number was arbitrary. And he said, you know what, I think we need more science behind this. So we heeded his advice. We took folks like Dr. Finkel and others and came up with 1454, and we added all the science that anybody could ever need. We presented it back, and when the time came to determine whether or not House Bill 1454 would come out of committee, Representative Walter Stapleton did the right thing, and he supported this bill. It came out of committee, ought to pass. It passed overwhelmingly in the House, and he was the impetus as to why we're here today. So I think we need to give a round of applause to Representative Walter Stapleton for what he did. We would not be here without it. And Peter, I'm going to ask you to play Walt Stapleton's walk-up music for us because I think everybody will enjoy it. Go ahead, Pete.
Now I talk to weeping willow how to cry, cry, cry. And I shoot the clouds on the cover of a clear blue sky. And the tears that I cry for that woman are going to flood you, big river. And I'm going to cry here until I die.
Actually talked to Walter last night and I said, look, I hope you don't mind, I'm going to have you walk up to Johnny Cash. He said, I love Johnny Cash. I said, well, okay, I guess I'm not doing anything wrong then. All right, so our final speaker for this afternoon now, this morning, is a colleague of mine who I worked very closely. He is recently retired after 35 years in the technology field. He held senior management roles at Teradyne and Amphenol, including responsibility for global sales, marketing, applications, engineering, and general management. His educational background includes a business degree from the University of New Hampshire and an MBA from Northeastern University. Please welcome the president of North Country Alliance for Balanced Change and my friend, Wayne Morrison.
Everybody a big favor and not sing one note to start. I also want to say that in my life I've had the opportunity to play for championship sports teams. I've worked for highly credible Fortune 500 companies, working with a group of people that I came to love. I have never been prouder to be part of an organization, a coalition of people volunteering their time for a more worthy cause than what has resulted in House Bill 1454. Thank you. It's such a pleasure to look out and see a sea of blue and having people coming from all over the state to be here today. Your efforts have been instrumental in driving public awareness and making clean water a legislative priority in 2022. That would not have happened without all of you. I also want to thank our legislators in both the House and the Senate for their bipartisan engagement and support in overwhelmingly passing House Bill 1454 earlier this spring. Today, we ask them to once again stand up for New Hampshire, protect our irreplaceable water bodies, and override the governor's misguided veto. As you heard today, House Bill 1454 is a simple, smart, and pragmatic bill that addresses a glaring weakness in our existing landfill siting regulations. An arbitrary, one-size-fits-all, 30-year-old, 200-foot setback regulation is both inadequate and dangerous. Imagine two-thirds of a football field trying to protect our water bodies from a large, complex landfill. To put that in perspective, from the front door of this Capitol, if you look behind me to that lamppost, that's 200 feet. And if you think of what a landfill is, 100, 200, 300 acres that is 100 feet high, are you kidding me that that's enough protection for the people of New Hampshire or for our water bodies? That is no way. And this should have been solved in 5 minutes, not in 5 years, and we need them to do the right thing today. The people of New Hampshire and our environment deserve better protection, and the science-based, site-specific setback requirements in 1454 deliver just that. When the inevitable leachate spill or leak occurs, and it will, the last line of protection of our precious water bodies is determined by the porosity of the soils and bedrock and the time and setback distance provides to detect and mitigate that contamination. Why then would we ever choose to take on the unnecessary and foreseeably higher risk when the community harm and devastating economic impact of water contamination is so great? I ask you again, why? House Bill 1454 has no impact on existing landfills or expansion of existing landfills. House Bill 1454 will not prevent new landfills from being built. It will not affect landfill capacity in the state. It will not raise property taxes, and it will not cost taxpayers and developers additional time or money. What House Bill 1454 will ensure is that if and when New Hampshire needs another landfill, it will be safely sited based on science and scientific hydrogeology of the site. Over the last 4 years, our coalition of grassroots organizations and legislators have been working to enact change and improve protections. Today, more than ever before, warning lights are flashing brightly in the background as stories of water contamination are far too frequent in New Hampshire and across the country. Forever chemicals like PFAS are constantly in the headlines, and scientists are increasingly alarmed about the dangerous impact on our health. You heard that story earlier today from Merrimack. House Bill 1454 is long overdue and a vital step forward to protect New Hampshire water bodies throughout the state. The danger is real, the science is clear, and the time to act is now. We urge all House representatives and senators on both sides of the aisle to stand up for New Hampshire and override the governor's veto on 1454. We thank you and thousands of people who have joined us in solidarity for this critical reform. We will continue to stand together for New Hampshire's environment, for community health, and to ensure that future generations of Granite Staters can experience the clean water, the clean air, and the pristine open spaces that make us love New Hampshire. Let's live up to that promise and take that important step today and override the governor's veto of 1454. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Wayne. Thank you, everybody. But, you know, while we have a minute, we do have some representatives and senators walking around here, the State House. Let's take this opportunity to say thank you. Yeah, 1, 2, 3, thank you. And then 1, 2, 3, override 1454. Ready? 1, 2, 3.
Override 1454.
Do the right thing. Do the right thing. Do the right thing.
I stand corrected.
Do the right thing.
Override the veto. One more time. 1, 2, 3. Override the veto. Thank you. Override the veto. Override the veto.
Override the veto.
Thanks to our slate of speakers. Thanks to everybody for taking time out of your busy day to be here. It means, you know, so much to us, and hopefully it's resonating with all the people here that are serving the great state of New Hampshire. We thank them for their service. If you don't have anything to do, first off, we can't have Wayne eating all these snacks, so we're inviting everybody to come over and please have a bite to eat. We also have these reusable bags that are gifts on behalf of NCABC and the members of the coalition, so please come and take one. And if you have time, hang around, because you know what? This is a public place, and we're all welcome. We're able to go in to the gallery at 1 o'clock and watch the House in action as they evaluate a number of bills that were on the slate that the governor vetoed. And I believe that we are sixth in line. House Bill 1454's review is number six. So leave your signs outside, but you're welcome to go into the halls. There's a very large gallery. I think we should go show our support and watch our representatives in action. First priority is move this out of the House and get it over to the Senate so that they can make a decision. Yes. Linda.
Representative Linda Mouse-Miller.
Want to use the microphone?
Linda, come on up, kid. Sure.
Hi, everybody. I'm Representative Linda Mouse-Miller, and I represent the towns of Littleton and Bethlehem, and I'm one of the co-sponsors of 1454. But what I want to say is, thank you to all of you, because you are our warriors. You are our champions. You are the ones that make the phone calls, send the emails, write the letters. We're just your facilitators. So no matter what happens today, and hopefully it will be positive, but if it isn't, I promise you that we will move forward with exactly what we've got today, and we'll get it done. So thank you.
Thank you, Representative. Thank you to Linda, who is a co-sponsor of the bill and has been a very strong member of our coalition. So thank you. Round of applause for Linda again, please. So what we've actually done today has been absolutely fantastic, and it's probably a good opportunity for us to take a photo. And I would like all of the speakers to kind of stand over here, and then behind them and to the side, all of our supporters. What a great photo opportunity. Let's do that. So all of our speakers, if we could move over here, and then we'll get some pictures of all of you and all of our speakers as we gather here today. So thanks again, everybody. Big round of applause. We need to do the right thing. We're going to override this veto.
Override the veto! Override the veto! Override the veto! Override the veto!
here to talk about and ask for an override of the governor's veto on HB 1454. There are many people in the balcony. There were people here on the plaza. We've had petitions. This is a bill that has enormous enthusiasm around the state. It's a bipartisan bill. It was from the outset. There were people in northern New Hampshire who were very concerned about the issue of landfills. Small groups of people gathered. Then those groups grew to larger groups. There was an effort between the House and the Senate. There were people who joined groups. We had warrant articles at town meetings supporting this idea. And we moved across town lines, then across county lines, and now it's become clear that this is a statewide issue. This last year, we have learned a lot more about contaminants and groundwater and PFAS and bacteria and all these things we don't really like to think about that can happen under our feet. When we can't see it, we think everything is fine and it's not fine. Now, at the last minute, we're hearing rumbles that there are claims that this bill will affect potential expansions of existing landfills. But that's just not true. There's a key sentence in this bill which I want to read to you. Nothing in this paragraph of this bill shall be construed to prohibit the expansion of any landfills that are in operation at the time this paragraph takes place. This is very important. This makes it so this bill is something that can be passed now to deal with an imminent problem and to protect our very precious waters all over the state. As the prime sponsor, let me assure you that it was always my intention, as well as the bipartisan sponsors in the House and Senate, to craft a bill that applied only to new landfills. We believe we succeeded and that it is impossible to read that sentence any other way. We have concurrence on a phone conversation that was lengthy with Director Wimsatt, and I assure you that there is nothing here that could be a problem. At the moment, three Republican speakers are ready to speak to this bill, but no one signed up to oppose this override. So I leave it up to the three speakers, Representative Walter Stapleton, Representative Matza.
No.
Oh, I can't do that? I'm sorry.
No. Sorry, Representative, we can't do that.
Okay. Well, so you're the one who does it.
I will announce the speakers.
Thank you. And they can decide what they want to do about speaking. That's really up to them. Meanwhile, I urge you all to do the right thing, to do it now, to pass this bill that so many people have worked on collaboratively for so long. Thank you.
Chair recognizes Representative Stapleton.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I stand, I arise to support the override of the governor's veto to make HB 1454 law. Water is life. The bill is reasonable and common sense protection of our water resources from potential leakage from landfills upon any breach or failure of linings. Many people will say linings never fails. Some says they're quite apt to fail. we can't take a chance. Locating landfills on permeable soils without sensible buffer distance to intervene upon failure is irresponsible. The bill's five-year travel criteria enables detection and remediation to be well ahead of a contaminant leakage and migration to surface waters. Then did the arbitrary 200 feet existing law, which just might not be enough buffer to preclude polluting our surface waters. The time and travel protocol is a science-based answer to uncertainty, has been utilized in other states to assure sufficient setback relative to various soil and strata conditions. This technology approach has been increasing in use since 2003, and our neighbor state of Maine, has used it successfully for 15 years, even with a six-year multiplier. The veto note mandates that the Department of Environmental Services contract with an engineer or hydrologist pursuant the SB 396 reference in it when evaluating a landfill permit. Well, that's fine, but it sorely lacks two things: the qualification of the engineer or hydrologist, and the specific process that should be involved. It is therefore inadequate for the purpose of really protecting the waters. HB 1454 fills that gap, provides scientific process for protection, and we should enact it into law. So I ask you to please press the green button to enable this bill to enter into law and protect our precious water resources. Water is life. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Chair recognizes Representative Simon.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My colleague did a wonderful job explaining the content of the bill, so I won't take much of your time this morning, other than to say when this bill last came to this chamber, it passed on a unanimous voice vote. And it seems like there are some rumblings and some changing of opinion. And in fact, it might seem strange that I would be up here arguing for this bill, this override of this veto in the first place, because on my side of the aisle, we value very highly free markets and low regulation and allowing businesses to do what businesses do. And we believe that because we believe that if we let people do what they do best, then all ships rise. And the standard of living of all people will rise as we allow people to do what they do best. But of course, I would almost never go against those principles, but all things have exceptions. And I believe that this bill presents an exception to that rule. And I'd just like to remind my friends in this chamber that earlier this year, I suspended my convictions of those rules as well to help the people of Merrimack because their waterways were compromised. And we stepped in and we required of business to remediate problems due to their waterways, because without water, you don't have anything. And it doesn't matter how highly we elevate the standard of living of people, if they don't have clean water to work with, then they don't have anything. So coming from the North Country, we're not opposed to more landfills. You know, a few of my colleagues have said, well, yeah, you don't mind siting landfills unless it's in your backyard. I have one in my backyard. I've had one in my backyard for 20 years. I know what it's like to have a landfill in your backyard. We're not opposed to having landfills in the North Country. We have two operating at the moment. All we want is for those landfills to be situated reasonably away from our water sources. Our environment is the basis of our economy up there. If we ruin our waterways, people don't come hunt, they don't come fish, they don't come do water sports. If our fish are compromised, if our animals are compromised, it does great damage to our economy in the North Country. And so we're just asking for common sense legislation. We don't mind setting another landfill. We just want it adequately separated from our waterways so that our waterways can remain safe. I hope that you will see this the way that I do, that you will vote green to overturn the governor's veto on HB 1454. Help us protect our waterways for the future. Thank you so much.
Chair recognizes Representative Gay.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. This is my last day. This bill is one more step toward aligning our New Hampshire DES RSAs with good engineering practices for safe landfills. My son-in-law builds them. House Bill 1454 does not apply to existing landfills. It only applies to landfills yet to be built. And there's no pressing need to build more of them right now. This bill allows expanding the ones that we already have. The Mount Carberry landfill just received approval to expand through 2041. The Nashua Four Hills landfill is currently seeking a 30-year expansion through to 2052. And when we do need more trash capacity, the New Hampshire Department of Environmental Services has shown that 86% of land in New Hampshire is hydrogeologically suitable for siting a new landfill. Currently requiring only 200 feet between a landfill and a water body reveals a lack of concern about hydrology and soil infiltration. We've come a long way from the superficial claims that clay liners last forever, and landfill leaching poses no dangers to our lakes and rivers and coastal waters. We cannot risk having more leaks such as occurred at the Bethlehem landfill in May last year, endangering the Amonoosuc River. New Hampshire has already has its share of Superfund sites. Based on hydraulic conductivity tests, this bill requires that any landfill proposal near a perennial river, lake, or coastal water will need to be far enough away that it would take 5 years for leachate to reach the water. The five-year travel distance can be reduced as low as 2 years if the landfill construction company incorporates adequate additional engineering to further control the leaching. We have a chance to protect New Hampshire lakes in a big way from multi-million dollar businesses, namely landfill owners and trash haulers. The New England state that keeps authorizing more landfills is likely to end up with the biggest landfills filled with millions of tons of trash from out of state. Maine already refuses untreated trash to be brought into their state. As more comes to light about the chemical pollution in trash, more adjoining states will still want to deliver their trash to any other state that will accept it. This bill got its start after townspeople from multiple communities had been trying for years to protect their lake. But they were little guys trying to hold the line against a huge company with enormous resources. New Hampshire citizens should never have to endure such a battle again. Prevention is way cheaper than cleaning up contamination. House Bill 1454 will be a milestone in the ongoing race to protect our priceless New Hampshire waters. Please press the green button to vote once more to preserve our precious rivers, lakes, and coastal waters. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
House will be in order. The motion before us is notwithstanding the governor's veto, shall HB 1454 become law. State constitution requires a roll call. A two-thirds vote is required to override a veto. This will be a roll call vote. Members take their seats. motion before us is notwithstanding the governor's veto, shall HB 1454 become law. State constitution, house will be in order. State constitution requires a roll call. A two-thirds vote is required to override a veto. If you're in favor of having the bill become law, you will press the green button. If you're opposed and wish to sustain the governor's veto, you will press the red button. Voting stations are open for 30 seconds. All members present had an opportunity to vote. House will attend to the state of the vote. The House will be in order. The gallery will contain itself. The vote is 256 yea, 65 nay. The veto is overridden. I will clean the gallery if you continue having outbursts.
Thank you, Mr. President. House Bill 1454, relative to permits for siting of new landfills.
The question is, notwithstanding the governor's veto, shall House Bill 1454 become law? Is there any discussion? State your inquiry.
Hopefully I'll get it right this time. If I want to override the governor's veto, would I vote yes, Mr. President? And if I want to sustain the governor's veto, would I vote no? Is that correct?
If you're going to override the governor's veto, you're going to say yes. If you're going to sustain the governor's veto, you're going to say no. A roll call is required. Are you ready for the question? The clerk will call the roll.
Senator Guida.
No.
Senator Bradley.
Yes.
Senator Waters?
Yes.
Senator Prentice?
Yes.
Senator Gray?
No.
Senator French?
No.
Senator Ward?
No.
Senator Ricciardi?
Yes.
Senator Kahn?
Yes.
Senator Daniels?
No.
Senator Avar?
No.
Senator Rosenwald?
Yes.
Senator Carson?
No.
Senator Whitley?
Yes.
Senator Kavanaugh?
No.
Senator Reagan?
No.
Senator Susie?
Yes.
Senator Birdsill?
No.
Senator D'Alessandro?
Yes.
Senator Perkins Cuoca?
Yes.
Senator Gannon?
No.
Senator Sherman?
Yes.
Senator Morse?
No.
The noes have it, the governor's veto on House Bill 1454 is sustained, lacking the necessary two-thirds vote. Do we have the last bill?
Beautiful state, a lot of people live here and visit here for a reason, and we want to protect and preserve our natural environment and resources from river exploitation and
and degradation. I mean, like we're seeing in Merrimack and other places. So, especially with the rising threat of PFAS contamination. I mean, in essence, you know, it seems like the governor's helping to pave the way for a PFAS factory in an area where there are no PFAS contaminants currently. So, you know, it's sad, but we'll be back next year. We have statewide support now for this effort to not only stop this dangerous landfill in the North Country, but at the same time, to wake others up to the threat posed by further exploitation by corporations that come to New Hampshire because of our lax regulations.
What do you think the message is?
Lawmakers gathering in Concord this afternoon to address legislation vetoed by Governor Chris Sununu. None of those vetoes were overturned, but the House did vote overwhelmingly to save legislation that would have raised the bar for putting landfills near bodies of water, which is being closely watched in the North Country. That override effort came up short in the state Senate.
It's sad, but we'll be back next year, and we have statewide support now.
North Country lawmakers say, North County lawmakers say that they will not give up, and they plan to bring back this landfill siting legislation next year.